Hello, this is Clem Games, and welcome to our first look at Kingdoms and Castles, a medieval fantasy city builder developed by Lion Shield LLC and released on Steam in July 2017. For disclosure, I received this game for free. In general, I do like city builders since there is an element of relaxation to it, as you slowly build up your city and simply watch it as the people go about their daily lives. The earliest example of a game like this that really hooked me is Pharaoh by Impressions Games and published by Sierra, who did also publish titles like Zeus, Master of Olympus, Cleopatra, and Emperor Rise of the Middle Kingdom. More recent efforts in the genre include Lethe's Path of Progress, Townsman, and the in-development Rise of Industry, which was formerly known as Project Automata, some of which have been covered on this channel. Kingdoms and Castles is perhaps a little lacking in the overall package, since certain features are not present, such as a campaign, unique missions, a tutorial, or even any objectives really. But I do like the core city building mechanics, which is not overly complex since it did not have a million different types of resources to manage. The voxel art style is also pleasant, and the game does have some interesting ideas with regards to not just city building, but castle building as well. Before we begin, there are three difficulty levels, with the first having no enemies, the second having occasional enemies and raids, and the third having more frequent raids. Of these, I chose normal difficulty, which allowed me to experience the game as a whole. However, I can see how easy difficulty might be ideal if you are looking to unwind and simply want to build up a thriving kingdom. As mentioned, there is no tutorial in the game, so it just kind of leads you to start building up your kingdom on your own. You have to place your keep, which is the hub for your kingdom, and houses your advisors who can give you some advice on what to do next. The basic building resources are wood and stone, which are obtained from chopping trees and mining rocks respectively. More houses must be built in order to attract more villagers, but more people means more food required as well, leading to a need to build farms and orchards. Time does pass in the game, with the coming and going of winter signaling the end of the year. Crops must be distributed to the houses or kept in the granary before winter arrives, otherwise it is lost. Your citizens do have a happiness meter as well, which is influenced by the individual happiness of each household in the kingdom, which are affected by several different factors, such as whether the house has road access, well access, whether it is within range of a library, church, or town square, whether it is next to the sea, whether it has food and charcoal for heating, etc. And as a result, when you do build up your kingdom, there are several factors to consider all at the same time, which is one of my favorite aspects of such games, since this meant that some planning and forethought must go into the layout. In addition to the above, there is a castle building aspect which has its own tab, meaning that you could place castle walls and archer or ballista towers on said walls, with their attack range being determined by the height of the wall. Adding in a vertical element to the castle building was a pretty cool innovation, and I hope to see this more in city builders. Archers and ballista are a necessary component of the kingdom, since every so often, enemy Vikings will begin a raid in your town. Additionally, dragons will occasionally be sighted flying around, and these enemies are more concerned with wanton destruction of your meticulously built town. In later encounters, ogres also join the fray, and these large, lumbering monsters can do some serious damage to your buildings and defenses, as was the case when one took out my large granary, severely affecting my food storage. While the raiding and random monsters was an interesting idea, I did not really feel like there was much of a consequence. For example, after a Viking raid, they simply left and I had to rebuild, and that was pretty much it. I suppose that on the hardest difficulty, where a game over will occur when happiness is too low for too long a period of time, that these invasions will be more critical to defend against, but I thought that it lacked a lasting effect on the kingdom. The lack of an objective is one of the major sticking points that I have with the game, since in the later parts of the game, you simply have to sit back and set the game on triple speed to watch it go by, watch the resources go up, and continue to expand your kingdom. From what I can tell, the one main goal seems to be to get your population as large as possible, since there are pop-up notifications for when your village grows in size, from a quiet hamlet to a small town, to a burgeoning town, and so on, with several Steam achievements being tied to these. On the other side of the coin, one positive result of this decision is that you are simply allowed to build for as long as you like. However, this does bring up the point of map sizes, which does seem to be fixed and not all that large. However, based on the default size, it does take some work to fully build over the entire land mass. Finally, the developers seem to have a development roadmap for the game, despite it not being an early access title. For example, the latest news post on 21st July states that they are adding in merchants and ports to the game, and there does seem to be quite a bit of momentum behind the game, so I do hope that more and more features would be added. Anyway, that will do it for this video. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Leave a comment if you like. Thanks again, and I will see you in the next video.